Okay. Karl Marx is a German philosopher, and he was a writer, he was a journalist, he was an activist, and he has many facets in his life, and he used to be one of most influential figures in the modern world. Karl Marx was born on the 5th of May 1818, and he died on the 14th of March 1883. He's basically, you know, he's an economist too, historian. That Marxist economy is quite different from capitalist economy, and also a large portion of the world was governed based on Marxist philosophy, Marxist economy, for a long period of time in the history, particularly in the 20th century. You know, the Soviet Union, right? The Soviet Union was governed. There were two camps in the world. One camp was led by the United States, and the other camp was led by the Soviet Union. That was a bigger coalition, that was a bigger union among many countries, many socialist countries that were governed on socialist and Marxist ideology. Throughout the 20th century, you witnessed that conflict between the world led by the camp led by the US and the camp led by the Soviet Union. Soviet Union, the Republic of China, and Soviet Union, China, North Korea, Vietnam, Cuba, all of those countries were directly influenced by Marxist teaching. Right? That we call that Cold War time, Cold War period. That means that you didn't witness any present war, any active war, or any cohesive war, any physical war, but it was a cold war. That means that underhand things, all the soft things, soft strategies were adopted by those camps during their Cold War politics. For example, space missions were part of Cold War politics, because there was race between the United States and the Soviet Union in connection with space missions. For example, that all the Apollo missions were done in response to the space missions done by the Soviet Union. Okay, that Cold War politics is quite different from today's politics. Then, but the Soviet Union was collapsed at the last part of the 1980s, okay, particularly 1988-89, you saw that how the Soviet Union was collapsing. The reforms introduced by Mikhail Gorbachev called Perestroika. After introducing Perestroika reforms, they kept aloof from all the socialist policies, and that now Russia is no more a socialist country. It's governed by liberal democracy, right? And but influence made by, influence exerted by Karl Marx cannot be underestimated at any grounds. Even you cannot say Karl Marx is wrong yet. Applications were the Soviet Union, applications were the China, applications were Vietnam, North Korea, Cuba. These are certain applications. Those leaders, Mao Zedong, who applied Marxism into his country in his own way. Right? Joseph Stalin applied Marxism in his own way in the United States, in the Soviet Union. Fidel Castro applied his Marxist teaching, Marxist model, in his own way in Cuba. Right? Currently, you are seeing how Kim Jong-un is applying Marxist socialism in North Korea. Right? These are applications. Not Marxism. Application of Marxism and Marxism itself are two different things, two different phenomena. Okay? For example, like I will explain that this way. Buddha preached a doctrine that's called Buddhism. Application of Buddhism happening in different forms. Here, there are two chapters, Mallathu and Asgiri. Ramanya, Amarapura, there are different chapters. In Sri Lanka itself, in Japan, it's called Zen Buddhism. Application of Buddha's teaching, that's called Zen Buddhism. In China, it's called Chen Buddhism, right? In South Korea, it's another form, right? Then Buddhism, then what the Buddha taught is different from the application of Buddhism. You cannot gauge, you cannot measure Buddhism by Ramanya Nikaya or Zen Buddhism or Bon Buddhism in Tibet. You cannot give a clear picture, you cannot paint a clear picture about what the Buddha taught through their applications. The same thing is correct with Marxism. Marxism was applied in different contexts. Lenin applied Marxism in Soviet Russia. Mao Zedong applied it in China. These are different applications. Okay? But anyhow, Marxism was highly influential doctrine in our history. Even in philosophy, as said, that we were talking about philosophers like Jean-Paul Sartre, Michel Foucault, those philosophers were highly influenced from Marxist teaching. Marxist thought, right? Due to his political publications, Marx became stateless. Okay, Marx became stateless because of his political publications. He used to be a journalist and he used to be a socialist activist. Due to his political publications, he was exiled. He lived in exile with his wife and children in London for decades. For many decades, he lived in London. He was supported by his friend, okay, where he continued to develop his thought in collaboration with German thinker Friedrich Engels. Friedrich Engels, this doctrine also called Marx-Engels theory, right? Not only Marx himself, but Engels too contributed to develop this doctrine, right? Then both of them were researching on this new form of system of beliefs, ideas, right? They finally came up with a gamut of literature on Marxism, right? Marx published with Friedrich Engels the Communist Manifesto, the most celebrated pamphlet in the history of socialist movements. That Communist Manifesto is still being cited by many scholars and being used by many politicians, being used by many academics. Communist Manifesto is a book. It's a book on how a communist system can be achieved and interpretation into this world. That if you want to trace, if you want to figure out Marxist interpretation on this world, then you will have to go through Communist Manifesto and Das Kapital. The next book was Das Kapital, or The Capital. Das Kapital in German. In English, it's The Capital. How capital works. Right? Das Kapital is a foundational theoretical text in materialist philosophy, economics and politics. Karl Marx preached this ism that's called materialism. Materialism. He came up with this idea in contrast to idealism. That, for example, his teacher Hegel, Wilhelm Hegel, is an idealist. Idealist interpretation of the world. They thought mind is primary. Ideas are primary. Idealists thought ideas are primary. What you think, what you preach, what are the ideas you adhere are primary. But Marx revolted it. Marx said that no, ideas are not the primary thing. Materialism. That means how material relations, how the world, how these economic structures work. He said that nothing beyond from this material world. For example, that if you believe in something outside of any, if you believed in any realm, something like divine realm or some divinity, or something that is idealistic thing. Materialist thing is you and me. All of these things are material. Right? They have been created by people. We are living in a materialist world, and Marx came up with that idea, class consciousness. Right? He said that even our ideas, right, even our ideas are material. Even our ideas are material. Right? That means if you grow up in a certain setup, if you grow up in a certain material background, that your ideas are shaped by that background. Right? Your family, your system, your culture, your material things, your class would decide your ideology, your views, right? According to Marx, our ideas are too material, right? If you, for example, in my views, if you cuddle a dog in the street, okay, if you take care of a man, if you do compassionate on a beggar in the street for some period of time, right, then he or she will start to respect you, right? He or she will start to love you, because these are because our material interaction created their behavior, their perception, their views on us. Our material behavior, right? That how we communicate with this world, right? How we interact with this world, our material existence create our ideas. That's the basic idea of materialism. Our ideas are not something out from us, that what we do, that means how we interact with this material world will create our ideas. Then ideas are not idealistic, ideas are material. Right? Ideas are material. Right? For example, Marx also gives this criticism on bourgeoisie marriage, right? That marriage in the present world is totally a material thing. See, all the proposals in newspapers, he has this car, he has 3-story building, he has this big estate, he has this big salary, she has this big salary, she has this millions of money, she has this dowry. These are transactions, right? These are material transactions, right? Then you say that your family is finally reduced to a material transaction. Your parents would not allow to marry a girl or boy from extremely poor family, because this is a material interaction, this is a material relationship. Right? Even you don't prefer to choose your partner from highly deprived social stratification, social layer. Because finally this is material. Our ideas, our perception on love, our perception on blah blah blah, are material. Because the entire world is a giant web of material relationships. Our ideas too are material. That's what Marx told us. Marx aimed to reveal economic patterns underpinning the capitalist mode of production in contrast to classical political economists such as Adam Smith, David Ricardo, John Stuart Mill, for example. Adam Smith, David Ricardo, they particularly thought of a world with individual freedom and market driven. That means they believed particularly that we can consider Adam Smith as the father of this modern economy. Adam Smith told us that prices of commodities will be decided in markets, in open markets, will be highly beneficial for the society. He said that there is an unseen hand. He said that market competition should be encouraged. Market competition should be encouraged. For example, this laptop, I can remember that back in 1990s, how these computers were expensive. Okay, those days, I mean, that your hard disk is only 1 GB. But you will have to pay that your hard disk is 1 GB, RAM is 128 MB, that your desktop, right? Finally, it costs you around 100,000 rupees those days, back in 1990s, right? Though nowadays, that the content of these computers have changed drastically. Right. that new features have been added, capacities have been improved, and cost has reduced. Nowadays you can buy a desktop for around 30,000 rupees, a new desktop computer with far more better qualities than the previous computers. Then this is because of market competition, right? Adam Smith said that after the market competition, that end consumer will get the advantage. But in contrast to Adam Smith and the all other political economists, classical political economists, Marx said that this mode of production, that market competition, is not the final solution for humanity. Right? I will showcase how he said that. Anyways, that this market competition actually have left us disappointed in some point. At the same time, we have reaped some benefits through the market competition. That when it comes to Marx did not believe capitalism is the ultimate evil. Capitalism is not the utmost bad thing for Marx. Capitalism is better than slavery, the system where slaves were used for the production. Capitalism is better than feudalism. Marx's view is that the human history should be evolved from slavery to feudalism to capitalism and then to socialism. That's Marx's view. That people enjoy some freedom, some benefits in capitalism as compared to slavery, but he said that we need to evolve more. That socialist system is far evolved system than capitalism. Socialism is not the final destination for Marx, it's communism. Socialism and communism are two different entities. Communist world is, we haven't seen a communist world. Communist world is a stateless world. In a Marxist notion, communist society is, there are no classes in a communist society. Even you will not have to use money in such a society. According to Marxist theory, in a communist society there are no classes, even no money. Production is quite different from the capitalist system. That he wanted to finally come up with such a class. But that socialist projects failed in certain cases, particularly in Soviet Union. Socialist model was failed, right? Even in China now have adapted to market socialism, but it is not that orthodox version of socialism. It's quite different. In capitalism, conflict between the ruling classes, known as the bourgeoisie. Bourgeoisie, okay, it's the ruling class that control the means of production, and the working classes, known as the proletariat. The working class that enable these means by selling their labor power in return of for wages is manifested. Then, in that Marx identified two major classes in this society. One class is the ruling class, the bourgeoisie, the ruling class. The other class is the working class. In Marxist philosophy, in Marxist view, ruling class controls the means of production. Okay, means of production means that all the physical elements and even, for example, tools, machinery, officers, the chains of production, these are owned by the bourgeoisie, the ruling class. Working class can only sell their labor. Can only sell their labor. For example, who am I? I am a laborer. Okay? I am a laborer because I sell my labor. I don't own any means of production. I don't own that chains. I am not part of the mechanism. I don't own that mechanism. I just sell my labor. Right? And I take some wage. That's what means labors. Okay? The laborers do, they sell their labor and they take some wage. But the bourgeoisie holds ownership of means of production.